Hello everyone, I am Dr. Raina Tembe and today we shall be discussing about the normal MRI brain anatomy. Let us start by having a look at the cerebral hemispheres. The cerebral hemispheres lie above the tentorium cerebelli and are conventionally divided into the frontal, parietal, occipital and temporal lobes by the various sulci and fissures. The central sulcus, also known as the rolandic fissure, forms the boundary between the frontal and the parietal lobes, separating the motor cortex in the precentral gyrus from the sensory strip in the postcentral gyrus. Its identification is important when surgery is planned in the vicinity of the motor cortex. So how do we identify the central sulcus? On axial imaging, we first identify the superior frontal sulcus separating the superior and middle frontal gyrus. At its posterior limit, it forms a right angle with the precentral sulcus. The next sulcus posterior to it is the central sulcus. On midline sagittal images, we first identify the cingulate sulcus which runs superior to the cingulate gyrus. At its posterior limit, almost vertically above the splenium of the corpus callosum, it divides. The marginal sulcus ascends to the vortex. The surface notch immediately anterior to it in the cortex is the central sulcus. On the lateral sagittal images, a Y-shaped sulcus is formed by the anterior horizontal ramus of the inferior frontal gyrus and the ascending ramus of the sylvian fissure. The next major fissure posteriorly is the precentral sulcus, with the central sulcus being the next major fissure posteriorly. The parieto-occipital fissure separates the parietal and the occipital lobes. The sylvian fissure separates the frontal and parietal lobes from the temporal lobe inferiorly. The cerebral hemispheres are linked by the corpus callosum. The corpus callosum is a myelinated tract which appears hypo-intense on T2 weighted images and hyper-intense on T1 weighted images. On sagittal section, it appears as a curved structure. The genu or the rostrum is the anterior most portion which blends into the anterior commissure. The genu curves posteriorly and superiorly towards the body and then to the splenium of the corpus callosum. The splenium of the corpus callosum is the most posterior portion of the corpus callosum. The fibers of the corpus callosum sweep anteriorly into the frontal lobe, known as the forceps minor, and into the occipital lobe, where they are known as the forceps major. Let us have a look at the basal ganglia. The basal ganglia consists of the caudate nucleus, the lentiform nucleus, the claustrum, and amygdala. The amygdala is associated with the limbic system, and we shall be discussing about it in a separate lecture. The caudate nuclei are C-shaped structure lying along the lateral ventricle. The head of the caudate nucleus indents the frontal horn of the lateral ventricle, with the body lying adjacent to the body of the lateral ventricle. The tail of the caudate nucleus lies above the temporal horn of the lateral ventricle and is not readily identified on MRI images. The lentiform nucleus is divided into two by a sheet of white matter into a smaller medial component, which is called the globus pallidus, and a larger lateral component called as the putamen. The caudate and the lentiform nuclei are together known as the corpus striatum. The claustrum is a thin sheet of gray matter interposed between the gray matter of putamen and insula. It is separated from the putamen by the white matter of the external capsule and from the insula by the white matter of the extreme capsule. The upper motor neuron fibers arising from the primary cortex join the corona radiata and converge on the internal capsule, which forms the medial boundary of the lentiform nuclei. It is a myelinated tract appearing hypointense on T2 weighted images. On axial section, it appears V-shaped with the genu pointing medially, separating the anterior and the posterior limbs. The corticobulbar fibers are present in the genu, and the corticospinal fibers are present in the posterior limb. These corticospinal fibers have relatively low myelin density and may appear as rounded foci of high signal intensity on T2 weighted images. The brainstem comprises of the midbrain, of the pons, and the medulla. The midbrain is also known as the mesencephalon, and the pons, medulla, and cerebellum together constitute the rhombencephalon. Let us have a look at the midbrain now. The midbrain consists of paired cerebral peduncles and a dorsal tectum. Each cerebral peduncle consists of the crust cerebri and the tegmentum, which are separated by a pigmented gray matter tract known as the substantia nigra. The crust cerebri contains the corticospinal fibers. The tegmentum lies ventral to the aqueduct of the sylvius and contains many nuclei, amongst which the red nucleus can be easily identified at the level of the superior colliculus. The nuclei of the cranial nerves 3rd and 4th are situated within the midbrain. The cavity of the midbrain is the cerebral aqueduct. The tectum lies posterior to the aqueduct and consists of 4 colliculi or quadrigeminal bodies. The superior colliculi is associated with the visual reflex and the inferior colliculi is associated with the auditory reflex. The pons has a bulbous ventral portion and a dorsal tegmentum. The ventral portion is continuous with the cerebral peduncles of the midbrain and contains the corticospinal fibers. It mainly contains the transverse fibers which pass posterolaterally as the middle cerebellar peduncles. The dorsal tegmentum contains the cranial nerve nuclei of 5th, 6th, 7th and 8th nerves. The medulla is closed inferiorly around the central canal. This closed medulla extends from the level of foramen magnum to obex. The closed medulla appears pear-shaped on axial imaging and may be rotated. The anterior eminences are formed by the pyramids and the posterior column form the posterior eminences. At the level of foramen of Magendie, the medulla appears square-shaped. On either side between the ventral median fissure and the anterolateral sulcus is an elevation called as the pyramid. Lateral to this is another elevation called as the olive. On the lateral surface of the medulla, there is an indentation corresponding to the post-olivary sulcus. On the dorsal surface of the medulla, we can identify the dorsal median sulcus. On either side are the fasciculus cuneatus and gracilis transmitting the posterior column fibers. Further cranially, the anterior eminences are formed by the pyramids and olive. The posterior eminences become more prominent, forming the inferior cerebellar peduncles. The dorsal surface of the medulla becomes the floor of the fourth ventricle. Along the lateral aspect, the fourth ventricle communicates through the foramina of Luschka with the cerebellopontine angle cisterns. This is an important pathway for the spread of the intraventricular tumors into the subarytmoid space. The medulla contains the cranial nerve nuclei of 9th, 10th, 11th and 12th nerves. The cerebellum lies posterior to the brainstem. The cortical mantle of the cerebellum overlies the central white matter core. The various folia and the intervening sulci are almost parallel to one another. The gray matter of the cerebellum has a tree-like configuration in section and is called as the arbor vitae. The cerebellum consists of midline vermis, which is separated by a paramedian sulcus from the cerebellar hemispheres. The deep transverse fissure divides the cerebellar hemispheres and vermis into 3 lobes, each of which is made up of multiple lobules. The primary fissure separates the anterior lobe from the posterior lobe, and the posterolateral sulcus separates the flocculonodular lobe from the posterior lobe. The nodule is the only lobule of the flocculonodular lobe and can be identified posterior to the fourth ventricle. The flocculus is largely separate from the rest of the cerebellum and can be seen extending laterally inferior to the vestibulocochlear nerve. The cerebellar tonsils can also be identified lying posterior to the medulla. 3 cerebellar peduncles arise from the cerebellum. The inferior cerebellar peduncle or the restiform body is vertically oriented and passes to the medulla. The middle cerebellar peduncle, also called as the brachium pontus, is horizontally oriented and passes to the pons. The superior cerebellar peduncle or the brachium conjunctivum is vertically oriented and passes to the midbrain. It forms the part of the lateral wall of the fourth ventricle. The diencephalon is situated between the cerebral hemispheres and brainstem and borders the third ventricle. It consists of the thalamus, the pineal gland, habenular commissure and the hypothalamus. The habenular commissure and pineal gland are together known as the epithalamus. The pineal gland is an ovoid gland situated between the two superior colliculi in the posterior wall of the third ventricle. Two laminae can be seen arising anteriorly from the pineal gland. The superior lamina is the habenular commissure and the inferior lamina is the posterior commissure. The anterior commissure forms the anterior limit of diencephalon. It consists of myelinated fibers within the lamina terminalis. The thalami are olive-shaped paired nuclear masses forming the lateral walls of the third ventricle. They are opposed in the midline at massa intermedia or interthalamic adhesion and are separated from the lentiform nuclei by the posterior limb of the internal capsule. The pulvinar projects over the midbrain. The hypothalamus forms the part of the floor and lateral walls of the third ventricle. The infundibulum lies posterior to the optic chiasm and passes to the pituitary gland. Its width varies in different individuals, but it should not exceed that of the basilar artery. The pituitary gland fills up the pituitary fossa and is situated above the sphenoid sinus with cavernous sinus on each side. The height of the pituitary gland varies with age, but it should not exceed more than 9 mm. In females of childbearing age, the pituitary gland has a convex superior margin. The anterior and posterior lobes of the pituitary gland can be identified separately. The posterior lobe of the pituitary appears hyperintense on T1 beta images due to the presence of the neurosecretory granules within. In neonates, the pituitary may appear uniformly hyperintense. The limbic system comprises of the limbic lobe, olfactory apparatus and septal areas. We shall be discussing this separately. Let us have a look at the cerebral ventricles. In young adults, the ventricular system normally contains 20 to 25 ml of cerebrospinal fluid. The lateral ventricles are C-shaped cavities with corpus callosum as their roof. Each lateral ventricle has a frontal horn or the anterior horn which projects into the frontal lobes anterior to the interventricular foramen of Monroe and body which is posterior to the interventricular foramen. Each lateral ventricle has a temporal horn and an occipital horn projecting into the temporal and the occipital lobes respectively. The third ventricle is a narrow midline structure with diencephalon as its boundaries. The fourth ventricle appears triangular in sagittal section. It has an anterior floor and a roof with two sides converging to a posteriorly directed apex. The floor of the fourth ventricle or the rhomboid fossa is formed by the posterior surface of the pons and the upper medulla. The upper part of the roof above the apex is formed by the superior cerebellar peduncle and superior medullary velum. The roof below the apex is formed by the inferior medullary velum. The inferior medullary velum has a midline aperture called as the foramina of Magendie. The CSF is formed by the choroid plexuses. The choroid plexuses are imaginated into the medial walls of the lateral ventricle and into the roofs and the floors of the third and fourth ventricles. The CSF flows caudally from the lateral ventricles into the third ventricles and fourth ventricle. The CSF then flows into the basal cisterns and into the cortical subarachnoid spaces overlying the cerebral hemispheres and is absorbed by the arachnoid villi into the venous system. A small amount of CSF circulates around the spinal cord. The subarachnoid cisterns are situated at the base of the brain and around brainstem, free edge of tentorium and major arteries. These cisterns communicate freely with each other. The cisterna magna lies between the medulla and the postero inferior surface of cerebellum. It receives CSF from the fourth ventricle via the foramen of Magendie and Luschka and is continuous below with the spinal subarachnoid space. It contains the vertebral and posterior inferior cerebellar arteries and 9th, 10th and 11th cranial nerves. When the cistern is very large, it is called as the megacisterna magna. The pontine cistern is anterior to the pons and medulla and contains the basilar artery and 5th to 12th cranial nerves. It is continuous with the interparenchylar cistern superiorly and the quadrigeminal plate cistern posteriorly. The chiasmatic or supracellar cistern extends from the infundibulum to the posterior surface of the frontal lobe and it has uncus on its either side. It contains the part of the Sylvian fissure and the circle of Willis. Superior to the supracellar cistern is the cistern of lamina terminalis containing the anterior communicating artery and superiorly is the callosal cistern containing the pericallosal artery. The cistern of velum interpositum is limited anteriorly by the interventricular foramen of Monroe. It communicates posteriorly with the quadrigeminal plate cistern and contains the internal cerebral vein. The quadrigeminal plate cistern lies along the superior surface of the cerebellum and continues superiorly towards the splenium of the corpus callosum. It is the location of the venous confluence of the vein of Galen with the inferior sagittal and straight sinus and contains the posterior cerebral, posterior choroidal, superior cerebellar arteries and trochlear nerves. The ambient cistern surrounds the midbrain and contains the posterior cerebral and superior cerebellar arteries, the basal veins of Rosenthal and the trochlear nerves. The cerebellopontine angle cistern is limited medially by the pons, posteriorly by the flocculus of the cerebellum and laterally by the petrous bone. It transmits the facial and the vestibulocochlear nerve, the antero-inferior cerebellar artery, the petrosal vein of Dandy and trigeminal nerve in the anterior portion. Lastly, let us have a look at the meninges. The meninges have three constituent parts, the fibrous dura mater, avascular arachnoid matter, and the vascular pia mater. The subdural space is a potential space between the dura and arachnoid into which hemorrhage or pus may occur. Its existence is controversial in normal individuals. The subarachnoid space is between the arachnoid and pia and contains CSF. The pia is closely applied to the cerebral surface. The dura has two layers. The outer layer is the endosteum and the inner layer covers the brain and forms the falx and tentorium. The cranial dura has two layers which separates to enclose the dural venous sinuses. The dura appears relatively hypointense on MRI. The falx may occasionally calcify or ossify, appearing as region of signal void due to calcification or hyperintense due to the fat within the marrow. The falx cerebri is sickle-shaped and extends from the crista galli anteriorly to the internal occipital protuberance posteriorly. It forms an incomplete partition between the cerebral hemispheres. The tentorium cerebelli is attached from the posterior clinoid process along the petrous ridges to the internal occipital protuberance. Its upper free medial border surrounds the midbrain, which passes through the tentorial incisura. The uncus and the posterior cerebral arteries lie above the free edge and are at risk of compression against the tentorial edge when there is raised intracranial pressure in the supratentorial compartment. The free border anteriorly encloses the cavernous sinus and attaches anteriorly to the anterior clinoid process. The falx cerebelli is attached superiorly to the posterior part of tentorium. It terminates just above the foramen magnum. The diaphragm cellae forms an incomplete roof over the pituitary gland and is pierced by the infundibulum. Thank you.